Tonight, it's an all-new Burt Reynolds special.
I was in a rather strange period in my life at that time, and I was in trouble in certain areas, and I had a rather short fuse, as you remember.
And, that was very hard for both of us, that
would be. It was.
Conversations with Dolly Parton.
Now, you're doing a movie with James Woods.
Mm-hmm, are you, Jim?
And you've been saying all these nice things about him.
My girlfriends want to know how he kisses.
He kisses good. Okay. He kisses good, and so does Bert.
Conversations with Tanya Tucker.
You're so beautiful. Like, why didn't you ever get married?
It's because those vows are, will you do this, I'll do this, I'll do that, I'll do this till, you know, tomorrow. Mm-hmm. I can only say what I'll do today. I can't promise you anything tomorrow. But I'll tell you I love your butt right now.
Conversations with Lori Morgan.
But the tabloids are...
I don't really mind it. I mean, I really don't.
No matter what this is.
I don't do that.
No, because I feel like the people who love me and the people who are closest to me know the truth.
Conversations with Kathy Mattea.
I'm going to say something about you. Now, don't be embarrassed, all right?
I'm already embarrassed.
Get a look at the private side of country music's most popular women.
You think of boobs, you think of me, and if you think, you know, yeah. If there's a story about boobs, you're going to think of that. So, of course, the tabloids are going to get it. So
that's
it said Dolly's breasts are killing her.
You do have a very sexy yodel.
From the Grand Ole Opry in Nashville, it's an all-new one-hour Burt Reynolds special. Next.
Center of the capital city of Tennessee, just off Fifth Avenue North, is the historic Ryman Auditorium. It's an old brick building that truly embodies why Nashville has every right to be called Music City, USA. The Ryman was built in 1892. Sarah Bernhardt, Enrico Caruso, and Will Rogers were among the many legends that played the Ryman. However, in 1943, that was the year the Ryman became the home of the Grand Ole Opry and earned a place in country music history forever.
From the Ryman Auditorium in Nashville, the original home of the Grand Ole Opry, it's Burt Reynolds' Conversations with Miss Dolly Parton, Miss Kathy Mattea, Miss Lori Morgan, and Miss Tanya Tucker.
Dolly. You remember Best Little Whorehouse in Texas?
Great.
Well, I read somewhere that you liked working with women better than men.
Now, I know that doesn't mean anything what they write in the papers, because God knows the things they've written about me. You could send everything below my belt to Harvard. But you got to remember that we did have an awful good time on that picture.
Oh, we had a great time. No, I said I usually have great success with women, but I love working with the men.
Oh, is that what it was?
That's exactly what it was.
Also, the picture made $100 million.
I know, and I never got my part. That's what I'm mad
picture.
About. I never got my money.
I didn't
but
either.
To be honest, I loved working with you. I think we should do
y'all
were great.
Do another
yeah, it was
we had the
yeah,
best time.
Great.
I was in a rather strange period in my life at that time, and you know, we all go through little periods.
Mm-hmm.
Not all of us. Some of us are strong. But I was in a period there where I was in trouble in certain areas, and I had a rather short fuse, as you remember. I turned into an 800-pound gorilla like that.
And, that was very hard for both of us, that would be.
It was.
I was fat as a bear. And
no,
I was
you weren't fat as a bear. But anyway,
both were great.
Gosh, all the laughs that we had with everybody on
and
the
And Jim course. Neighbors.
And Jim Neighbors.
It was a hoot.
Jim and you and I, one night at the house, I remember you two singing great. Me listening a lot. And telling stories about every, you know, because in the South, if you have a crazy person, we don't put them away, we show them off.
Yeah. That's right.
And
that's
right.
So you were talking about the crazy, there was a crazy person in your, I guess, in that little town where I have property.
There are, and I can't call names.
You can't call the name.
Can't call names because they were relatives.
You mean they were partners?
Well, you know, that there were a lot of wonderful moments on that picture, although we were both going through a hard time emotionally at the time. We had a great time with the whole cast. It wasn't us. Mm-hmm. It was like there was a lot of things going on with that picture where it came from a Broadway musical, and there was a lot of...
I remember... at the premiere in Austin, Texas, and I was sitting, I think, with the governor, or you were with the governor, and I was with the mayor, or something like that. And a man who shall go nameless, but he wrote the original show, so it won't be that hard to look him up. And he was sitting right behind you, saying the most awful things.
No.
And I got, and I'm from the old school, see?
Yeah, uh-huh.
And so I got up to just take him, his head off, and I came around, and they got him, and they moved him out. And so the next day in the papers, he said some terrible things about the movie and about us and how we ruined his play.
He didn't want us in this.
Right.
He felt we ruined it.
And they said, do you have a comment? And I said, yes, I'm going to hit him so hard that both his parents are going to die.
I don't know if you girls, I know you know something cheap and superficial. Most of us have done it with Bert.
I beg your pardon.
No, I'm joking. But Bert is a great singer.
You got that one right over my head.
Bert did a song called Something Cheap
and Superficial. Let's do something cheap and superficial.
Let's do something cheap. And he had a hit record.
Kind of the way I felt most of my
It doesn't matter whether you have this. There are people who have great instruments that can't give an honest reading of a song. And
you know what George Jones said last night? We were talking about somebody, and he said, he's never going to make it. And I said, why not? And he said, he sings too pretty.
Yeah.
And I thought, what do you mean? He said, well, he just sings too pretty. He said, there's nothing. Nothing's been trashed.
Yeah. Right.
Well, that's a good way.
It's an interesting thought. I remember once going to Las Vegas and seeing a very famous singer. And he was very handsome. And he had a great voice. And I remember Sinatra said, this guy's the best pipes in the business. And looking at him and saying, wow, this guy is handsome, and he's singing. And then I went, I want to get out of here.
Yeah, when you sit there and you realize everything's perfect and I don't feel anything.
Yeah, and I just want to get out of here. And then you go see someone who doesn't have a great voice. I mean, who doesn't, but there's some magic.
I took it the other way.
Yeah.
Fine.
Yeah.
But it is true that they're stylists, obviously.
Yeah, absolutely. Can't sing, but I can say all
right. Right.
Yeah. But just like Johnny Cash. I mean,
that's
Johnny,
what he said. I can't sing, but I can sail.
People, he's like John Wayne of country music to me. It's like when Johnny talks, you believe it. You mm-hmm. want to hear him. So everybody has their own style, I think.
You know, what's wonderful is that when I ask these young ladies who they thought were special and who they wanted to emulate and who they thought, and your name was on the list of all three of them.
Well, that's nice.
It's better than that. Also, I probably get asked more about you. It kind of pisses me off, actually. Than me. I get asked about you so much, and I always say she's exactly what you
what
think
you
she
see.
Is. What you see is
what you get.
Now you're doing a movie with James Woods.
Mm-hmm. Are you jealous?
And you've been saying all these nice things about him.
My girlfriends want to know how he kisses.
He kisses good.
Okay.
He kisses good. And so does Bert.
So everybody
Bert.
Knows now.
So does Bert.
It's all right. I'm way over it.
Yeah.
You're way over it.
I'm way over it. I don't know. I don't even talk about I did last night. I just talk about how good a bowel movement I
have. Oh, sure. I remember this is the funny thing I'm going to tell you. You won't mind. When we were kissing on the best little chicken house in Texas.
You can say warehouse.
No, well, I know.
Warehouse.
I was just trying. Yeah, warehouse. But anyway, when we did our kissing scene, Ed Earl, the sheriff, you know, they had his hair real black and Bert's hair real black, and they had to put his mustache.
They had to black his mustache.
So when we did it, but I didn't
black
know that.
Over your lips.
And so when
I
we
came
did
back, and I was looking at Groucho Marx.
It was so weird. I look like I've been sucking a sow. You know,
yeah,
like
you
I just had black all over
We were
my
into
face.
It, though.
You're definitely envious
of all the women in this country.
We could definitely tell that we were not just pecking
at. She was envy at my house, I guarantee you.
Really. Well, we had other great kisses, but this is the movie.
There were others, huh?
There were others. You were my first love in the movie.
You was my first love before the movie. I saw you before the movie. Do you remember we did that special at Governor Dunn's house?
We certainly did, and that was years ago.
You came in, and I almost, well, forget it. You had this soft hair. It was so unbelievable. I never saw skin like that in my life. It was like, you know, baby's milk. And you sang this little song, and I thought, if this lady doesn't go to the movies, she's out of her mind.
And then I did. My Prince Charming came and took me into the
house. I didn't have anything to do with it. You just left town.
But I appreciate you giving me the chance. You've been doing these kinds of things in Nashville for many years. And I was saying that earlier, before we started the show on Entertainment Tonight, they said, why did you want to do this? I said, I would do anything for Bert because he has done everything for us. Years ago, when you were like the... which you still are to all of us, the biggest star, but the biggest box office draw at a time when you could have been anywhere and done everything. You were still promoting people like us and country music.
I have always loved this town. I always loved this town. And I've always been crazy about people like Don Williams and Don Steele and Mel, who makes
sort of unassuming.
So much. Your husband, you met at a laundromat?
Yeah, 1964, when I first came to Nashville.
You know, he was on the set one day, and I didn't know who it was, and I looked over, and I said, damn, look at that guy. That's the best looking. And he had on he looked like a Marlboro ad. He had a brown jacket with that sheepskin under it. And I said, who is that guy? He's gorgeous. And you said, that's my husband. I said, are you kidding? She said, no. He looks good, don't he? Wow.
A lot of people don't even know he exists.
I don't even know what he looks like.
I think he's gorgeous.
But he's a very nice man, too.
He is.
Well, you have a perfect relationship because you hardly ever see him.
He's got a great sense of humor, too. In fact, I have a funny Bert story where he's concerned. Back when we were doing the movie together, they had us in the tabloids, Dolly and Bert, hot romance and all that.
You're not in them now, are you?
No.
But anyway, that one day he came in, he picked this up, and so we had this little Boston Terrier Bulldog was our little pet dog, and I came in and he'd put this little hat on him, put this little sweater on him, and he put him in my arms and he took the Polaroid camera. I said, what are you? He said, I want to take this picture. I said, why? He said, well, I'm going to send this and say, this is Dolly's and Bert's baby. Dolly has Bert's baby. So I said, we'll just add on to the story. So it was like this little brown-eyed dog.
The tabloids are amazing.
They're something.
They're amazing. People come up to you with these awful story.
Yeah.
And go, would you sign this?
I say, do you mean you want me to sign this right over the silicone leaf? Or where I had Elvis's baby.
Have you had a lot of silicone leak stories lately?
There was one two weeks ago. I was at the Super X the other day when we were leaving town, and I was getting some lip gloss and a couple of things. I put my brother there real quick, and there on the side, seriously, this lady was standing there, and they looked, and they were looking at me because I could see that there's like this picture of me that they shadow it up, and they make it, you know.
Oh, yeah.
And, of course, it is a legitimate
thing. They always make it bigger than it really is.
Well, they certainly do, whatever they want to. So anyway, of course, they had the stories, which are legitimate stories, and of course, I'm, you know, you think of boobs, you think of me, and if you think, you know, if there's a story about boobs, you're going to think of that, so of course the tabloids are going to get it. So
that's
it said, Dolly's breasts are killing her. And it says, and I was serious, and it said, family begs her to, you know, to have surgery. And this lady looked at me so sympathetic and sincerely. She said, oh, Dolly, is it true that your breasts are killing you? And I said, well, they're not bothering me a bit, but they seem to be killing everybody else.
That's why I love
them. So anyway.
The man who loved women.
I am the man who loved women.
That was funnier than heck movie.
Yes.
God dang, with the super glue.
Oh, yeah.
Dog. And
thank
walking
you.
Around.
You were the one that loved that one.
I did. I really did. I've had people go rent that movie to watch it.
Thank you. I rented quite a bit myself. Can I ask you about Dollywood?
Yeah, would you?
Yeah.
To be honest, I was so happy that you agreed to come to Dollywood because you kind of had a small part in helping name that. I remember when we were doing the Best Little Whorehouse in Texas, we were laughing, and I was saying I wanted to start some things, and we were talking about stuff, and he said, well, why don't you call it Dollywood? I said, something I want to have, like a Hollywood sound.
Yeah, yeah.
And he said, well, Dollywood would be like a great name, and I always thought
perfect.
When I would go into Hollywood,
because Burtwood doesn't work with it.
No. But it really, you know, so Dollywood, we've been open for 7 seasons now. Isn't that great?
Now, you have property
there.
I have a piece of property. It's a little bit.
We can't talk
please,
about
the
that
neighbors.
Here,
I hope the sound was on.
Yeah.
And it's in Sevierville, which is her.
Well, that's Dolly's.
Hometown.
Dolly's.
And I went to see her statue. Did you know there's a statue of her?
Yes, I knew, but I haven't seen it.
Did you wipe the
pigeon
poop off?
Yes, I did. And it was in a very strange place.
And I
almost got arrested because the man didn't know what I was doing. I said, I'm trying to get this pigeon poop up here. And he said, well, you better be, because we don't allow people rubbing those things.
Well, they do.
Miss Dolly, would you sing our song?
Only if she can play it for me.
If I should stay, I would only be in your way. Step up the way, and I will always love you. I will always love you.
This talking part I'm going to say just to you, and to you, and to you, and to you. And I hope life would treat you kind. And I hope that you have all that you ever dreamed of. Oh, and I do wish you joy. Wish you lots and lots of happiness. But you know what? Above all of this, I wish you love. And now we could all sing. Cause I
Reynolds and his guests will return.
Your daddy was a wonderful, wonderful singer.
Thank you.
Did you start singing real early with him?
I started singing around the house very, very early, like at age 5, where I really thought, this is what I want to be. Pantomime and all that stuff, you know.
Mm-hmm.
The first time I ever sang professionally was right here on this stage at age 13. And I can remember waiting right over there in the wings, right behind when Hal Durham used to be the MC here on the Opry. And my dad came out, and I was so nervous before I came out. I didn't even know if I wanted to do the Opry. That's how nervous I was. We used to get
probably
the stomach
your dad,
ache
though. Was it
and everything,
your dad?
You know.
Well,
he was emceeing the show and all that stuff, and I went back in the dressing room back here and I rehearsed Paper Roses with the Opry staff band, and I still didn't know if I wanted to sing. My mom got me a new dress for the occasion, and my dad was out here, and he said, okay, sit during the commercial, I'll look over at the wings, in the wings, and if you want to come out, you shake your head, and if you don't, you say no. And so I was standing over there, knees knocking, and my dad looked over at me, and I kind of went, I didn't know what I wanted to do, you know, still undecided, and it was time. And I walked right out here and sang at at 13.
And, you and
that
innovation.
Pole, that particular pole right there, is the pole that I stared at through the whole song.
The one right
never.
Had...
Wait a minute, where is it?
Right there. You know, the see it between the yeah. on the left side of that
I
thing.
I want to know because I want to know which pole you like.
I mean,
and you got a standing ovation.
I got a standing ovation.
Oh, that's great.
But what was funny is I asked Leon Rhodes, who was playing guitar that night and rehearsing with me. I said, what do I do if I get an encore? He said, well, you won't, but if you do, come back in and
sing. That's you won't. Pretty encouraging.
Yeah.
I'm not sure
well,
I want to go on, but what do I do if I get an encore?
George Morgan was one of the classiest people that we ever had in country music. He had the most beautiful voice.
And
he had a great
speaking
voice.
I also heard he was real funny.
He was funny, and he knew the best jokes. In fact,
yes,
that was one of the things I remember as a kid. When I first started coming to Nashville, he was always very kind to me, and that's why I've always had a very special feeling toward Lori. She's always been like a little sister to me, and I've always, you know, cared so much about her because George cared about me, and I've always told her that. But he told some of the dirty jokes.
Yes,
he did. Lori, don't you think you should make Bert do what you said?
Yeah.
No,
of course,
I can't.
You sing the song.
Well, I think you should.
I sing better off camera.
Well, he sings all the time. He's got that Dean Martin. Yeah.
Every time
everybody.
I love my favorite Dean Martin story is he had this very large glass of booze and he was about to walk out on stage.
Did he drink?
A little bit. and a guy said, "You can't go out on stage with that, Mr. Martin." He said, "You think I'm going out there alone?" Now, you also have horses, lots of horses, huh?
I have three horses, but we enjoy them a lot, and they're quarter horses. And
of course.
They're real good horses. We have a lot
quarter horses are great.
We have a lot of fun with them.
The quarter horse is the fastest, best working horse in the West.
At the biggest hindquarters.
Yeah.
I had
Appies for a long time, and then I had Arabs, and now I've had Andalusians, and I'm eventually going to get to quarter horses.
They're best. They I'm telling best. You, they're the best.
What did you name them? This is
real original name.
Candy Kisses.
Red.
Very good.
Red, white, and blue.
This is not a horse that I want to breed my horse to.
Cole?
Red.
All right, the red horse, his name's Red.
I got it.
The black horse is named
Black. Blackie.
No, Cole. And the other horse is
Whitey.
No.
Whitey.
Highway.
Highway?
Highway.
Red, Cole, and
no,
Highway.
No, that's kind of, Highway's Highway. A good, that's a good yeah. one. Now, how did Highway. That come about?
No, I have no idea how that name came. That was his name when we got him. So I just kept it.
Well, it fits well. So yeah, on the road.
That's right. I thought maybe you saw him walking down the road.
And I found him on the highway.
How do you feel about having a picture in your rags at the checkout?
Welcome to our world.
Long as they spell my name right. It's taken 17 years for them to get my name right. But, you know, I don't really mind it. I mean, I really don't.
No matter what they say.
Slide off your back.
No, because I feel like the people who love me and the people who are closest to me know the truth. And that's, you know, my friends are all who really matters.
Your fans, too.
I mean, I don't... Well, they're my friends.
Yeah, your fans are your friends.
Fans are friends, and I think that people who love you are going to...
Well, they ain't said nothing that bad about her yet. Everything's
I hated
bad.
Her for
well, maybe if there's something really bad out... Uh-huh. I mean, I might get a little bit.
What bothers me is that it hurts your
people around you,
parents, your friends,
family.
Hard. You know.
We used to buy them on the bus for entertainment.
Well, I don't mind them picking on me, but I won't pick on my people.
And when that sunk in, I can't remember. It might have been you on a TV show talking about it, and I thought I'll never buy one again. it's not funny.
What's happening now, which is disturbs me a lot, is that the major newspapers as their source.
Yeah, right.
According the one with the guy in the moon and the thing, the 800-pound baby born from the 70-pound woman. And that's what's really scary.
It's not even that, though. It's like, it's not even the lies that they write. It's the truth sometimes that they write. It's not any of their business. It's not anybody's business.
Why do they write it?
You know?
Yeah.
It's like, just because it's true doesn't mean everybody needs to know about it.
Oh, well.
I feel like you're
probably beating
them at their own game.
You can't stop it.
You can't stop it.
I've never met anyone. They
try to have as good attitude
I really
as
well,
you can, but
I don't
can't.
This is your initiation.
On me. Your son is named Jesse?
Yes, Jesse Keith. Wild man.
Wild man?
Yes, he is. but he's wonderful.
I love the name Jesse.
Thank you.
My dad's name.
He's named after Jesse James, actually. Yeah.
Do you have to discipline him?
Yes, I do. Jesse's a very sensitive child, and a lot of times you can just raise your voice at him and his feelings get hurt.
Right.
And when the discipline is over, then he's loved and kissed, and and the same with Morgan. But she's a very good child. She doesn't.
I see now. Morgan's 11. This is Tennessee. She could be married in a couple hours.
That's great.
You remember your first date?
His name was Goo Goo. And he, wait a minute.
This is a real like high IQ.
He was the Fonz of the school. He was Fonzarelli of Father Ryan, which was a. I went to an all-girl Catholic school, and he went to Father Ryan. And when he first came to pick me up, I was 15 years old. It was my first date, and we went to a Christmas dance. He walked in my front door, and my dad looked at him and said, "You need to shine your shoes, boy." He said, "I judge a man by the way he keeps his shoes polished and his handshake." Goo Goo gave him a good handshake, but my dad took him to the bathroom and shined his shoes before he took me out. My dad told him, he said, "You will always open the door for her, and you will always treat her like a lady." And ever since then, it's just been a natural thing with
you. You know what always impressed me, well, it really impressed me the first time I sat. I opened the door for the girl, and as I walked around, she slid over
and
opened my door, and I thought,
oh, I always do that.
Wow, I got it made.
I want Morgan in this day and age. I want her to still have men to respect her.
I'm a great believer, especially as actors and entertainers, that we make our own dignity.
Right.
And whatever we demand, we get.
That's right.
And she'll get as much as she demands.
And I believe that. I believe that.
Lori, I don't know if this will be painful for you, but I'd love for you to do your dad's song.
Candy kisses wrapped in than any of mine. Candy kisses wrapped in paper mean more to you than mine do, dear. Once my heart was filled with gladness, now there's sadness, only tears. Candy kisses wrapped in paper mean more to you than mine do, dear.
All right, that's great.
Thank you.
John Britt, Dolly, Kathy, Laurie, and Tanya, when we return. Miss Tanya, you got a standing ovation, which you call a standing...
Ovulation.
Ovulation.
The only woman on the Grand Ole Opry to get a standing ovulation.
And you deserve it, too. You know what was wonderful? Because I was watching that night. When you won, that everybody just...
Well, we all thought it was time.
Mm-hmm. Not only that it was time, but they also there was such love in them.
Well, that's, you know, to me, that was the award. That was the best. That was, if I had never won the award, and that would have happened, that would have been my fulfillment.
Were you shocked that everybody stood up?
Oh, I was. I don't know if shocked is the word. I'm laying there, and I just had my baby at 1:10. In the afternoon, and about 7:30, everybody left my room, and I was watching TV, and about 8:30 is when Roy Rogers said, "Well, baby and all." And I thought, well, now what's Reba doing with her baby now? Like a record deal or something? And it was so funny, because then Clint said, "I want to say something, Roy." And Tanya's watching from her hospital room, and she just named her little boy after her dad. Well, my dad had no idea. He's home on the couch, went, whoops, and he fell on the floor.
That's great.
Couldn't believe it. And plus, Roy Rogers is my dad's hero. So all those things just, I mean, it was like, Bertie was like, I was overcome.
See, we have all followed her since she was a little girl.
This is my 20th anniversary this month.
She's a great singer, and it's always good when you feel good about somebody that wins awards, exactly. When you say, that girl can sing.
Well, you say, not just
because
time.
I just gave it to her. And
but you know what, y'all?
She's been doing it a
the
long
way
time.
I feel about it, though, is like you've been Female Vocalist of the Year, Tammy Wynette. Mm-hmm. You know, and Tammy's still a great singer. I mean, Loretta Lynn.
Kathy Mattea.
I mean, it's
I'll just get under
you.
The table.
Hey,
you just wait a minute, you little whippersnapper.
But it's that, there's five women in that category, and that is an awesome place to be. I mean, top five, mm-hmm. and we're all completely, totally different. I carry that award in my heart for all the women that I hold, you know, and three of them are sitting here right now.
I watched you in the finals at the rodeo, and you can really set a horse. I think I ride pretty good, yeah. And to be on a cutting horse, I don't know if you've ever been on a cutting horse.
That's my love.
But they move and there's air under you. You know, I mean, you got to be able to sit. And she sits on this thing.
She's
so
daylight between that saddle.
You are
and
a wonderful, wonderful horse.
Well, thank you, Bert.
Who started you on horses?
About 14, I fell in love with a cutting horse trainer. And of course, I went out there and I looked out in that arena and all them old codgers out there, you know, look like they're about ready to.
Yeah, and everybody limps.
Yeah, oh, everybody's got a deal.
Not a good chain. No.
And I saw this blonde out there, and boy, he was just right. I said, And I fell in love. Of course, I couldn't date till I was 16.
When I was in junior high school, tennis and golf were sissy sports.
Mm-hmm.
During that time.
Now
it's real hard to get somebody to come over to your house and box you.
Hey,
because I box,
you never called me.
I box and play football, so it's real
out.
Hard to say, come on over, let's get through a little boxing. And I go over and play tennis, and they just kill me, and I hate it.
I love the box, Bert.
Do you?
Yeah.
Let's talk about that later.
Okay.
You started very, very young, like Brenda Lee and a whole bunch of people.
Right.
It does not
get easier.
Get old.
Or it don't get easier, it don't get old.
You've never walked through a performance.
I can be sick.
Yeah.
I can be.
That's what I mean.
Just.
You've never walked. What I'm saying is, you've never walked ever in your life walked through a performance.
I kind of slid through.
I don't believe it either. I've never heard you not.
Well, you know why we're talking about Miss Minnie a while ago, and I love
Minnie
all my
Pearl.
Friends have always not all my friends. I don't mean to say all my friends, but when I was young,
which is an hour ago,
just yesterday. Yeah, right. I'm very old.
Miss Minnie
said. They wanted to get quotes from people and what they were saying about me, and she said, well, I've never seen her fluff a show.
That's great.
That's what I'm talking about.
That wasn't like, yeah, she's great, she's wonderful. But it was, I've never seen her fluff a show. And that was
great.
Right.
Yeah, that's right.
You, forgive me, this is personal, but you're so beautiful. Like, why didn't you ever get married?
It's because those vows are you know, will you do this, I'll do this, I'll do that, I'll do this till, you know, tomorrow. Mm-hmm. I can only say what I'll do today. I can't promise you anything tomorrow. Mm-hmm. But I'll tell you I love your butt right now. I don't know if I'm your mom.
I have to ask you about
it.
Would you lay with me?
The controversy was
because
of your
song,
age or because of the
because
song?
Of, well,
or
the
subject
both.
Matter
no, both. Uh-huh. And in fact, I played the, I won't say right now, but I played a major rodeo in this country that we all know so well.
Mm-hmm.
And that was the only thing, is that the song was number one in the nation that week, and they hired me to do the rodeo, and I needed the money bad, so I didn't give them no bull. They had all the bull they needed. It. But they said, you can't sing that song. I said, that's all right. Just give me my money, and I'll do the rest of them. But it was number one in the nation, and so many radio stations wouldn't play it because I was 15 years old.
I love this song.
If you go down a little lower. Huh? Yeah. Would you lay with me in a field of stone if my needs were strong? Would you lay with me? Should my lips grow dry, would you wet them there in the midnight hour if my lips were dry? Would you go away to another
I would.
What the blood away from my dying in hell if I give myself to you? Will you bathe with me in the stream of light when the moon is full? Will you bathe with me? Will you still when I'm down and out in my time of drought, will you stand by me? Would you go away to another land, Detroit? Would you walk over through the burning sand? Wipe the blood away from my dying hand if I give myself to you. Would you lay with me? Would you lay with
me? You talking to me
or him? It
don't
matter. Join Bert, Dolly, Kathy, Laurie, and Tanya when we return.
Hi.
Hey. We're back.
We're all
doing our thing.
Kathy, I'm going to say something about you. Now, don't be embarrassed, all right?
I'm already embarrassed.
No, it's real nice. This is what's been written about you. The most naturally comfortable female performer to emerge in country music since Dolly Parton. She has a burnished mezzo-soprano sexy growl in her voice. And an irresistible
demi yodel.
I forgot the foggiest idea.
Demi yodel.
It's a way
anyway,
you
isn't that nice
it.
To hear that?
It's really
great.
Nice.
I was listening to this afternoon, which is really fun, because I had everybody's CDs, and I was listening to everybody's CDs, and I had a good time. And you do have a very sexy demi yodel. No, you have a very sexy character. And somebody, when you first started out, they were comparing it to Lady, oh gosh, I had such a crush on her, Anne Murray.
The same beautiful, smooth voice.
Yep.
That's a very rare.
I always got compared to whoever the low-voiced woman singer out at the time was.
Do you like someone who is not country that you totally admire? And
I have probably the most eclectic record collection you can imagine.
I do, too.
I can find something in almost every genre that I like. And there's, you know, there's really interesting music being made by lots of people that you never hear about, you know.
Do you have you ever done jazz? Sung jazz?
I've fooled around with it, but I've not been free enough to learn the improv as well as I really would need to do it to really jump into it.
What about you, Lori?
I have a wide variety also of record collection, if you may, but I love everything from Dionne Warwick to Johnny Mathis to Tammy Wynette, Dolly Parton.
Yeah.
I mean, I really do. I listen to everything. Stephen Perry. I mean, I'm a big Journey fan, an Eagles fan.
Danny?
Julio.
You'll sing with you.
Michael Bolton. Mm-hmm. And Ray Charles.
Mm-hmm.
And
Aretha
would be definitely. I mean,
what about Anita? Anita Baker.
Oh,
Anita
Baker.
Yeah, I like them. I love them all. But I mean, to actually go and buy a record, Bonnie Raitt, I guess, has probably been the one that I've always really.
Dolly.
Well, I've, like you, have been around through a lot of kinds of music, and I've been in different parts of the world, and I've really had an opportunity to work with a lot of people, and I, for for all of my life, although mountain music and bluegrass and gospel was really what was my great influence. But when I got into knowing that there were other styles of music, like Otis Redding and it's like the first, Mahalia Jackson was great. But I love all that smooth singing, the Johnny Mathis voices. And it helps me with control of my own. It helps me with my emotions. It's almost like everybody in every kind of music touches a part of my personality somehow. Even like classical music, when I was a young girl, I thought, oh, I don't want to hear that old loud, big old stuff. But then as I got older, I think as we do get older, we kind of mellow with age and we learn to like stuff that we didn't used to. But now, classical music and all those wonderful old, like Beethoven and Bach and all those things that I used to think, Lord, I'd never hear myself say that.
Yeah. What's fascinating is Mr. Sinatra, Mr. S, he has listened to all of you. And I know him very well. And his phrasing, I never understood what that
is. He has the most copied phrasing of any other singer.
That's the key to it all, I think, his phrasing.
Unbelievable, his phrasing.
He has, phrasing is important thing. Always has to do with, like, I think if I were just saying this to someone, how would I say it? Yeah. But his phrasing goes beyond that. It's like he does that, but he has a musical phrasing along with it, and they're like seamless. Mm-hmm. Do you know what I mean?
Yes, I do.
It's like how you should say
it. Well, because he's, part of it, I think, is because he's an actor and
got
a singer.
Got the world on a string.
But singing is kind of like acting,
Of course it is. He makes a 5,000-seat auditorium into a saloon.
And he makes everybody think they're singing like them.
Give me one for my baby and one more for the road. He's alone at the bar with the bartender. Mm-hmm. And he makes us, he takes us there. He paints us a picture, which is the best kind of singing.
I think that's the best, the most, anybody can play really loud and jump around and have a lot of energy and get your band members moving around and get everybody going. But the thing that's the hardest to me and the real test of a singer is if you can make the room seem so much smaller than it is.
Well, it's like when Kathy sings, Where Have You Been? I mean, you are in the same room, or if not that person, the old woman.
This is going to be our goodnight song, and before we start this, I want to say something. I've done three of these shows, and it's hard to say this because I'm so bad at this, but I really, really appreciate the fact that you're here, and I'm a huge fan of everybody that's here, and now even a bigger fan. And thank you.
And we love you too.
Likewise.
And
likewise.
God bless you.
Thank you.
Claire had all but given up when she and Edwin fell in love. She touched his face and shook her head. Tears fell to the floor until his key turned in the door. Where have you been? I've looked for you forever and a day. Where have you been? I'm just not myself when you're away. Thank you. snore. And now they're in a hospital, in separate beds on different floors. Claire soon lost her memory, forgot the names of family. Never spoke a word again. Then one day they wheeled him in. He held her hand and stroked her head. And in a fragile voice she said, "Where have you been? I've looked for and a day. Where have you been? I'm just not myself when you're away. No, I'm just not myself when you're away."
Burt Reynolds and his guests will return.
Cause she walks downtown with a suitcase in her hand, looking for a mysterious dark-haired man. In her younger days, they called her Delta Dawn. Prettiest woman has on.
Travel arrangements provided by Delta Airlines. Delta can now fly you to more cities across the country than any U.S. airline. And at Delta, we love to fly, and it shows.
I'll take you for my bride.
Buddy,
just come with me.